Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter, and it is my pleasure today to welcome Jack Morris, Executive Director of the Allen County Democratic Party, and Steve Schein, Chairman of the Allen County Republican Party.
Please don't put me on the same level. The ubiquitous
Steve Schein. You know, you're everywhere. Yeah,
Jack,
thank you.
How are you, sir?
It's good to see you.
Well, that may be the friendliest you guys get all day, or maybe not.
Well, on camera, you have to do
exactly
that.
Exactly, yeah. We are here to talk about two things primarily, the May 8th primary.
Yes.
Which is now fast becoming old news, except that it is taking us toward November and the general election. Before we get into the primary itself, real quickly, I think the turnout was about 17%. You guys feel guilty about that, not giving the public?
Probably not as guilty as the Democrats. They had about one-fifth of the vote that the Republicans mm-hmm. did. I think their top vote-getter was about 7,000 and some odd votes, where the top vote-getter on the Allen County ticket, Republican ticket, was Mike Pence, who had 30,000 plus votes. There was a lot more interest in the Republican Party's primary than there was in the Democratic primary, but it still does not excuse the fact that overall there was about an 18-point-some-odd percent turnout.
That's a pretty rapid go right into attack.
Yeah, he went from shaking your hand. Yeah.
I'm used to Kevin Knuth and Tim Pape. That's the problem.
Yeah, I tend not to take that approach, but really the amount of turnout is disappointing in recent years, and I think both parties. And the Republican side clearly had a hotly contested race that did bring people out. We, on the other hand, didn't really have any hotly contested race, so it's tough enough to draw people out when you do have competition. When there's no really hotly contested race, it's awful tough.
Yeah, your sexiest race was probably county council, which, with all due respect to them.
I might point out, though, that we were proud of, or at least, I shouldn't say maybe proud of, but went on the same level of turnout or near the same level back in 2008 when the Republicans didn't have that really kind of a sexy type of a presidential race, etc. And we still managed to keep right up there with the Democrats as far as voter turnout.
Well, let me turn the tables on you guys and ask you to be a reporter for a minute. I think I know the answer, but what was the kind of the headline Tuesday, May 8th? What should people remember? What was the big story that day that we ought to be talking about first?
The biggest story of the day is a man like Richard Lugar getting beat. Mm-hmm.
Not only beat, but crushed.
The size of the beating. He served. What bothered me during the whole campaign was, whether you agree or disagree with the viewpoints, the negative attacks, and for someone who has served our country well, even if he doesn't always vote for the way I think he should, he's a man who I always respected. And to see him get attacked and ripped up, I mean, that was one of the negative campaigns I've ever seen, and that was within their own party.
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, I hope that you take that attitude when your Democratic candidate for Senate runs against Richard Murdoch. I'll remember these words.
Unfortunately, I think they'll be the same kind of ads.
Regrettably, you know, that is what politics has, in some instances, been reduced to. We're asked to vote for the negative rather than for the positive.
Shaping up that way in the presidential race already.
People seem to be stimulated by negative attacks rather than things that are positive. Hopefully that will change. But the big story, of course, was the fact that Senator Lugar did lose, and by such a substantial margin. I spoke to Senator Lugar just yesterday, as I'm sure many county Republican chairmen did throughout the past week, expressing our gratitude for his 30-some years of service. Just a very gracious gentleman on the telephone. But he said something very telling, and that is basically he was not in tune with what was going on in the grassroots of Indiana Republican politics. And being a county chairman, I have to experience all the rough and tumble. If anybody would have asked, I would have said that there was a definite disconnect between the way the campaign was operating and what the grassroots was looking
for. Well, what was the defeat? And both of you can jump in. Was he beaten that badly because the campaign was out of touch, or because he himself was out of touch? And if you're a Murdoch supporter, you would say, well, if he hadn't lived in Washington for the last 30 years, maybe he would have been in touch.
I think it was something other than him just not being in touch. Steve may want to spin it that way. But the reality is his party has moved further to the right. Murdoch is espousing a lot of the beliefs that are bringing the votes out for the Republicans right now.
The Tea Party.
And it's a scary view.
We can all say what is scary, but don't forget the embracing of the Occupy individuals in New York City, the same people who trashed, defecated, urinated, spat upon the American flag, widely endorsed, of course, by Nancy Pelosi and sympathy from President Obama. These are all groups that have their own political agenda. They are part of the process. We respect the members of the Tea Party. They have helped crystallize some of the problems and concerns that average middle-class Americans see what is going on in Washington and want some correction.
Right. Well, the prevailing wisdom already is the campaign between Joe Donnelly and Richard Murdoch will be Murdoch's an extremist. Donnelly is an Obama clone. Tell me, Jack, what do you or the party PR machine, when you talk about Murdoch being scary, how so?
the idea that senators ought to be elected by the state legislatures rather than by the people, that type of view jumps out there. On the other hand, what we've seen is a track record by Joe Donnelly. Well, let me go to Murdoch also on wasting taxpayers' money to try to fight, force Chrysler into a bankruptcy. What an extreme position that was, and what would it have done to our economy and to the middle-class workers? Yeah. So that is a tremendous example. Not only would he have lost his jobs, but he was spending our taxpayer dollars to do it.
Well, I know Steve wants to reply to that.
The Chrysler issue is a red herring. In Howard County, where Chrysler has one of the largest operations in the state of Indiana, in Kokomo, the turnout for Murdoch over Lugar was something like 65-35. The Chrysler workers, the rank and file, they appreciated what Richard Murdoch did. And wow, what an extremist Richard Murdoch is. He was only elected by the highest vote total across the entire state of Indiana just in 2010, and I never once during that campaign heard that he was an extremist, that he was a member of the right side of the Republican Party. I heard nothing but glowing accolades about him. Now all of a sudden the Democrats want to demonize him by portraying him as some kind of right-wing off-the-wall candidate, and that's only to gain an upper hand in the senatorial campaign.
Well, it was no secret, I think, Jack, that the Democrats were pulling, if not outright campaigning, for Murdoch in the primary a little bit. Do you think Donnelly has a realistic chance at beating him in the fall?
Well, first off, I want you to know I wasn't. I had a lot of respect for Richard Lugar. I'd worked for his office when I was in law school, when he was heading up the presidential ambition of a fellow senator. And I have a lot of respect for him. So I wasn't necessarily rooting against him. I don't choose to make my decisions based upon what I think would make a race easier for my candidate. Mm-hmm. I would rather have a square off against who I think is the better candidate. And I think Richard Lugar was the better qualified, and I said that well before the election. I wasn't on a TV show like this asked to say so, but because if I had my choice, if it's not going to be Joe Donnelly, I would rather have it still be Richard Lugar.
Give me a real brief snapshot of why people should vote for Donnelly. He obviously didn't get much ink during the primary because there was no real competition, and so people may not know much about him.
How about if I answer that one? Well, he answered the one about a Murdoch. I think people should vote for Joe Donnelly if they're going to be voting for Barack Obama, and that's exactly why. Here is the guy who gave the, he cast himself as a blue dog Democrat, which are dwindling, I understand. They're going so far to the left under the Pelosi-Reid paradigm. Here is a guy who casts himself as a conservative, but yet the biggest piece of Obama liberal socialist legislation, Obamacare, was voted for, in favor of, by Joe Donnelly. And when you see the name Barack Obama at the top of the Indiana ticket, coupled with Joe Donnelly, I think it's a cinch that George Romney and Richard Murdoch will be successful in their races.
Now, you said George Romney, so
excuse
I think
me,
you're
I
showing
George,
your age.
I am showing my age.
And the
age.
Scary thing is I knew exactly who you were talking about.
Yes, yeah. Mitt Romney,
exactly.
Excuse me.
Nice of you to catch him on that. But,
Thank you, son. That's how I feel like it.
It is typical. What the Republicans choose to do is to label something and create negative tones to it, and then attach a person's name to that, and then use that name to label. In his short statement there, he did it multiple times. It's all packaging and smoke and mirrors, and that's the attack and the negative.
Well, I think you guys have both done that.
Oh my gosh! Can I say this? Oh my gosh! Here is what the state Democratic committee did just last week, when the Allen County Republican Party had its very successful victory lunch the day after the May primary. Almost every single elected official, as well as successful candidates on the May 8th ballot, were in the Republican headquarters. There's probably 150, 200 people there. And in that group was a particular Republican candidate that the Democrats thought they could get some mileage of by pairing him with Richard Murdoch so as to besmirch Murdoch, supposedly. That was an absolute falsehood. Your competitor with the morning paper pointed out what a stretch it was, how misleading it was for the Democratic Party to use those tactics.
You're talking about Bob Morris.
I'm talking about Bob Morris, who I happen to disagree with tying him with anyone because of the fact that the public will make that judgment this fall. But to try to put somebody together like that on a local basis, it's no different, Jay.
Well, I haven't done that. And I don't know what Steve is responding to, but he can choose to fight those battles and be negative in this meeting if he wants to. I don't. You know, when you asked me about Richard Murdoch, I told you about the factual things that I opposed and that I think are extreme. I didn't go after him personally. I didn't bring up the Bob Morris thing.
Your leadership in Indianapolis did, and Richard Murdoch was simply stating what the state constitution or what the United States Constitution said about United States senators back in the early days. I mean, he is a very good historian. He knows the United States history and some of the things that our founding fathers stood for that maybe we should be looking back right now to see what this country was made of in the beginning.
But once again, what we see here is I try to have a discussion. I try to bring up issues. And he's the one that wants to keep bringing it back. You know, sure, we can quote multiple people from our parties or his party who have said something bad or negative or attack. I mean, I could bring up all the Murdoch attacks and the Lugar attacks of each other, but have we accomplished anything in that discussion? Or are we just, again, attacking? I think we need to move away from that. And that's one thing I think you'll get in Joe Donnelly, someone who can work with the other side, who will try to work with the other side. You can label one piece of legislation and say, that's the man, or you can look at his entire record. First off, I defend that vote that he had on health care. We need universal health care. The rich need it as well as the poor. Our society needs it. The best way we protect against excess costs and things is to get people into medical care and preventative basis.
Well, as much as I love good conflict, which is always good TV, let's move on. Although I will tell you guys, I've got a 26-year-old son living in Indianapolis. Not real political, but he was watching the Murdoch-Lugar ads, and he says, don't they ever talk about themselves? You know, it's all about the other guys. So I will leave you and our viewers with that, and let's talk about a couple of the other races during the primary and how they will lead into the fall. Governor Mike Pence versus Evan Smith. My opinion would be it's...
You want to correct that. You had Mike Pence paired up against one of our House race candidates.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, that's all right. That shows you the name recognition. What's his name? Who's running for the Democratic seat. Mike Pence is probably one of the most popular leaders in the state of Indiana. I think this is, we're not going to run the campaign like this because if one gets too confident, you can't count on what will happen. But I think Indiana voters can count on Mike Pence to be the next governor of the state of Indiana.
And Jack, I'm assuming you would disagree.
Well, I would disagree on who they ought to pick because John Gregg, although he isn't that well known up here in the northern part of the state yet, when they get to know him, they will like him. If they'll look at his history, he served in the state legislature at a time that was 50-50, a lot of that time period. He was a majority leader during that time period. He had to work with the Republicans. All of the legislation had to be bipartisan then. He worked hard at that. He accomplished, he passed more bills than maybe all the in the legislative history under his watch, but in a single year. But that was from having to work across the aisle, reaching across, finding the middle ground. I think the people, when they get to know John, will realize the kind of person he is, and I think they'll say, yeah, that's who we want as a governor.
The kind of person he is to change his position to be politically expedient. Just recently, John Gregg said that it was not really a big deal that the Indiana legislature passed the right to work legislation that came through in this past legislative session. After he got a talking to by union leaders and by the state Democratic Party, he suddenly said that that piece of legislation was not a good piece of legislation, that it was a big deal against organized labor that it was passed. Again, he saw that what he said was a political faux pas going against the word and verse of the state Democratic Party. He was called to the woodshed, and here's a guy who changed his position within 24 hours.
First off, you'd have to listen to the context of the interview where that came out, and it wasn't that he was saying that it won't hurt workers for right to work to pass. It was said in a different context that it wasn't a bigger deal in that context. He's always been anti-right to work bill. His legislative history shows it, and in fact, they overturned it back then. So he's been strong there. Union never took him to the woodshed.
I think also when Indiana voters learned that he voted against the final piece of legislation that put a cap on and reduced Indiana property taxes, there'll be a lot of Hoosiers scratching their heads why they should elect a candidate for governor who voted against property tax relief.
Well, Greg has been here, and I'm sure he'll be back before November, so he should be better known, and we'll see.
Maybe he can come on the show.
Well, too, maybe. You never know, and I'll try not to call him Evan Smith. So
now you probably don't want to have me here.
Well, you and I have both made a faux pas now, so it's Jack's turn.
That's right. It's one and one.
Exactly. Real briefly, and I know the county races don't excite that many people, but we had a couple interesting things. You know, Nelson Peters, incumbent commissioner on the Republican side, absolutely crushed John McGauley, county recorder. And of course, Gordon Anthony was unopposed. He'll be facing Nelson in the fall. But on the primary side, first of all, did the margin of that surprise either of you?
And in the commissioner's race?
Correct, yeah. And does it mean anything?
A little bit, because they're both good men. And John McGauley is a guy who is full of ideas, just bountiful ideas.
Even though he thinks his big idea is
I also think that perhaps he had a little bit more faith in maybe the grassroots efforts. I mean, it does take money, and he was far behind in money. And Nelson ran a spectacular campaign. Mm-hmm. If Nelson Peters would have run the kind of campaign for mayor back in 2007 that he ran for commissioner in this past primary, he would have been mayor.
Well, in fact, I was told that was exactly why he ran the way he did this time.
It was
he didn't want to make the same mistake.
There were no mistakes in that campaign.
The journalist in me says it was a mistake for him to avoid any kind of a direct debate with McGauley. I think the public deserves that in a race, and I don't think he had that much to fear.
I did see them debate. That was at Allen County Republican headquarters,
which had been scheduled far in advance.
Right.
But yeah, he.
I don't think either one shied away from it.
Right. Gordon Anthony have a shot in the fall, do you think? And what issues might he go after an incumbent commissioner with? I know there's a strong union undercurrent on some of the county candidates, and I don't know if that would translate or not in the county race.
Yeah, Gordon will be talking about the importance of making sure government contracts respect workers and treat workers well. He's got a very uphill climb in that district. That district is extremely Republican. Mm-hmm. Gordon will run a good race. He's a great guy, a retired firefighter, very articulate on the issues, but whether he'll get enough public recognition, whether he'll get enough exposure to win that district, he'll have to work really hard to do so.
And well, not to correct Jack, but it is a countywide race. It is not just district. Yeah. He is elected.
That's my mistake.
That's all right.
Well, but technically, you're
it's still
both
the same district.
Yeah,
but he is elected by a countywide vote from that district.
Right. So I'll give you both half a point. So,
okay. The Jeopardy is a good game. I like that.
Of course, Bill Brown, former commissioner, was renominated for county council.
Super choice.
County council is all Republican. Republican now. Will it remain that way in the fall?
Without question, in my mind, we have got three super candidates: Bob Armstrong, Bill Brown, and Roy Buskirk. All of them have experience. All of them have been just gotten A pluses before from the voting public, and I can't see why this time it will change.
Well, I believe we've got a real chance to break into them there. We've got candidates at the county at large seats that are working hard. They're running. They ran good campaigns in the primary, something that doesn't normally happen in the Democratic primary, but they showed the desire, so they're already getting a message out there. I think we have a good chance to break through on that level.
Well, I give you credit for fielding a pretty full slate on some of the races in the primary, which you don't always do.
Well, you give your Democratic Party credit for that, but it took the Republican Party to have a Democratic candidate removed from the ballot because of that candidate making a mockery of the ballot. If that would have happened, that this candidate would have been allowed to be on the ballot with his nickname or moniker, as it was, it would have been a
legalized
yes, it would have been a black mark on Allen County. I don't know why the Democrats didn't step up to the plate instead of having the Republican Party have to challenge that.
My personal thought on it: overall, I am inclusive, personally. If someone wants to make a statement, to me, I think that's part of our government.
We're talking about David Roach.
Yes,
by the way,
we are. And I don't think by allowing him to do what he wants to do is in any way an endorsement. However, I wished he wouldn't. But in my process, I try to make sure that people know their voice can be heard. Individually, that's my desire. And so I chose not to challenge him because if he wants to have a voice, he wants to have out there. That's part of our political system.
There's a place for his voice to be heard. There's a place for messages, political messages, to be posted inside the voting booth on the ballot. Making a mockery of the whole process is not that place.
Yeah, that's really.
Although, in fairness, I think Roach has run on the Republican ticket prior.
Yeah, I hope the welcome mat has been pulled away enough times.
You know, to me, it's just Steve trying to bring up an issue that he thinks would muddy our party when, in fact, it's a non-issue. He can't believe that we endorse the actions of Mr. Roach, and
I just think you should police the ballot a little bit better to make sure it has got some integrity.
So we don't want it on the ballot, but he'd be allowed to have it on his signs in yards.
And
so,
that's true.
We're talking about
state law, though. The state law says that you can't be on the ballot without a nickname of which you are known by. No one is known by something like that.
Yeah, I don't know whether they are or not, but I chose not to investigate to find out. To me, it's just... Is that really an issue in your life?
It is not. We were just talking about the ballot, were we not, and how we could be proud of it.
Okay, well, moving right along. the Republicans still obviously dominate at the countywide level, but the Democrats have done a good job holding City Hall. What accounts for both of those, and what can be done to make each of you more competitive in that realm?
Well, it's... I think you're seeing the Democratic Party improving and working harder. I think you're going to see a lot of growth in our party in the coming years. We've got a central committee that's really aggressive and wanting to work hard right now, and we've got candidates that are willing to campaign. I can't speak to prior circumstances because I just recently became involved with the party itself. I was always involved with issues, but I finally decided you can't be involved just with issues unless you're involved trying to get people elected that can carry those issues forward. And since I've been in that, I've been really excited to see what's going on with the Democratic Party. What happened at the mayor's race is exactly what we do need to have translate to the county, and we're going to do that.
Well, it's not going to translate that way when Democratic mayors leave office or go into a second term by having misled the public. It was only a couple of weeks after the mayor was reelected did we find out that there would be nearly $1 million in repairs about which he knew about back in August to the city, county, or to the Citizens Square elevator system. It was only after the election was held, did he announce a 40% increase in water rates and utility rates? All of this stuff having been spoken about and have been conjured in the minds of his administration before the election, but held back so that he could win. The same thing that happened when Graham Richard left office. Very favorable contracts to I think it was the Sigma Group or a group of which he was involved in, and that was under question. In fact, it was not only so much under question that Mayor Henry put a stop to it in his administration. So perhaps the public will learn that these Democrats who have held office in the mayor's race are is not the panacea that they want. Look at our congressmen, look at our county council, look at our county officials, all Republicans, all full of integrity.
Well, I won't mention the, well, maybe Jack wants
well, no,
to.
Well, no, I actually won't go there because I think the mayor's work, he got elected because this city is in good shape. This city has been run well by Democratic mayors. The infrastructure, this mayor accomplished things in the downtown development. He brought bankers together when everybody thought a deal was done for the Courtyards by Marriott. He brought people together and did it. He brought people together and worked out the situation for the Harrison Square. He has done innovative, aggressive things. We are viewed as one of the best cities in America. And, you know, the opposing side can try to throw mud at things, but that's only because he's done a great job. The mayor has done a fantastic job with his city, and no one can really say otherwise.
I will say we have a great city, and there's been Republicans and Democrats helping make it that way. And our point will be to recapture the mayor's office and to show how much better the city can be under Republican leadership.
Just to correct the record, while you were giving the litany of Democratic problems, we did have a Republican mayoral candidate under indictment a few years ago. So
that's true. That made our party stronger, actually. We have come together and bounced back. You know, Jack says that he's new to this. I would point out that I have been on a multitude of interview shows, and I have yet, in the past 5 or 6 years, had the pleasure of having the Democratic chairman be next to me. We don't have it this time. What is it, John Cord? Is that his name? I'm not even sure 100% of his name. Mr. Bynum never came on with me. I want to know when the Democratic chairman is going to do his job.
Well, then Jack should be commended for coming on.
I like that.
And parrying
I like
with you.
That.
Apparently, I'm not good enough.
Sacrificial lamb.
Well, you're good enough for me.
Apparently,
what about me?
Steve, well, you're both good
Steve
enough.
Steve feels cheated by
I
being
do.
On air with me.
I do.
Well, and with that, I think the public has seen a good, robust discussion. And you know, if you like partisanship, you should enjoy it. If you think bipartisanship is the way to go, you're probably wondering, you know, how we ever get anything done. But I think we're just about out of time. So, gentlemen, thank you both.
Thank you,
Kevin. Appreciate
good
you coming.
To be with you.
It was
good. Thank
fun.
You.
Jack, thank you.
You.
And,
thank you, Jack.
Be sure to join us at www.news-sentinel.com, where you can see this and other episodes of the Fort Report. For Jack Morris and Steve Shine, I'm Kevin Leininger. Thank you.
So you can't invite me back.